like, no way. But then honesty, you tell you yes. It's like, wow. That's a real mind blower. Very, very humbling. Hey, that the universe, that reality is completely honest. There's no way to get around it. These ones that become our true teachers, oftentimes are very humble beginning surroundings. There's nothing that would indicate that they could possibly be a match for the world. Ridiculous to even think so. You know, we're looking for world beaters, you know. And they're just like nobodies. They're just entirely honest. Say, yeah, I'm nobody. There's no beginning. I have no beginning. I'm nobody. I'm not anyone. I'm not anyone. There's only everyone. There's only everywhereness. There's only everywhereness. There's only all universal being. All is universal being. That's it. And they're just honest about that. They aren't anyone. And we say, no, we can make you into someone. Don't worry. We're here for you. It's not going to work. I'm not going to waste my time. I've already wasted my time on Sri and Anandamayi. I'm not going to waste my time with this one. Yeah, I'm not going to waste my time. I think it was like 2 days. It took me about 2 days now. I said, forget it. Forget it. Because I've already been there and done that. Yeah, I'm not going to do it again. I'm not going to try to turn nobody into somebody. Yeah, that's a bitter path for sure. So once burned, twice shy. Of course, the world is saying, yeah, come on, you can do it. Help us out. You'll be a savior of the world if you can turn nobody into somebody here. We don't have to do with nobody. Nobody's here, and we don't have to do with it. Help us out. I said, no. Forget it. No, I'm not going to. But the world certainly is pressuring me. Come on, you can do it. I said, no, this one I'm going to leave alone. Forget it. I'm just going to let this nobody be nobody. Maybe. Always keep the maybe. Diplomatic here. You gotta be diplomatic here. Always be diplomatic here. That'll keep you afloat. See, I was non-diplomatic. That's why I'm sinking. That's why I'm in a bad spot. So this is the essence of the path. It's heavy, right? It's like, it's shocking. It's shock treatment. Really is spiritual shock treatment. When I was couldn't sleep, I had severe depression, and you know, just terrible from simply too much stress. Couldn't sleep, couldn't shut my mind off. Was, you know, the super depressed, you know, whatever they call it. You know, none of the medications worked. Nothing worked. I was in really bad, desperate shape. So I actually had shock treatment. Actually had shock treatment. So I've been through that. I know what it's like. It temporarily worked for just a little while, and then didn't work. It doesn't work. So the shock treatment that is given in the world for treating depression, it can work temporarily, but what you actually need is spiritual shock treatment, which is what I then began. When the shock treatment didn't work, what I did was I started spiritual shock treatment. Thanks to A Course in Miracles, thanks to Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. And so I've been doing this spiritual shock treatment ever since. And that's what works. That's what actually works. You can't avoid it. You can't use shock treatment to avoid spiritual shock treatment. You can't. I thought I could do it. I could be a kind of classic. I could come here and I could dispense with all of this continuity stuff and just explain clearly. Everybody would say, great, doesn't work. That's what led me into, well, the world led me into shock treatment. Okay, it was the demand of the world says, no. You know, you got to do this for us. You got to do this for us. So the world led me into that. And then I said, wow, that doesn't work. No way. So let me back off of this. I've got to find a way to back off of this because the continuity problem is too severe. Cannot push it aside like that. So I had to then change direction. Now the world's trying to push me into death at this point. And so I got to say no to that. No, it's maybe to that. It is a maybe to that. But not yet, but not now. Maybe, but not now. So. Maybe, but not now. See, if you come in the world as nobody, the world says, no, you got to be somebody. And they look at you, you're sick, you're crazy, you got to be somebody. Now, I realize my past lives, they pushed me so hard, I realize my past lives. They say, you were somebody. Well, so don't say you're nobody. Now people say they don't want to remember their past lives. That's fine. Because maybe they're working on trying to make it realize that they are nobody. But the world may at some point push you into that, and then you're going to have to deal with it. You say, wow, I really was somebody. You say, no. And then you have to work through that and realize, you've never been anybody. You've always only, there's only everybody. There's only all being. All along. All being all along. Say maybe. Maybe that's the highest mantra. Maybe is the highest mantra. Maybe. Maybe the world say, well, maybe I've met our match, and maybe not. But it's very intriguing. See, it shifts the intrigue in the world. In the right place. It got to shift the world's intrigue somehow. Now, my teacher's very intriguing, actually. If people see that, you know, wow. Very intriguing. For me, you know, too, it's just like, whoa. This incredible juxtaposition. Just super intriguing. And then need others to be very and super intriguing, too. So the world can get off this intrigue of death to prove that there was a birth, was a start. They want to engineer these endings so it proves there was a beginning. So they can shift the intrigue off of that onto a maybe. Like maybe there was no beginning and maybe there was, I'm not sure. And if the intrigue gets onto that, then we can sidestep the troubles that are coming in this world. Because sidestep is super important, so I told the Holy Spirit, do it. I said, yes, okay, I'll do it. So, it's up to the Holy Spirit to arrange everything. Round up the usual suspects. Get all the iconoclastics' attention onto someone else. It has to happen, there's no question about it. Because that's spiritual idealism. It's not spiritual pragmatism. The Holy Spirit deals in spiritual pragmatism. Deals in maybe. Already knowing where we have to be, which is where we are right now, which is an eternal, endless, all beingness. There's no beginning or ending. So that's where we are right now. And yet, we have to first be able to say maybe, okay? Have to be able to say maybe first. We have to be intrigued with maybe. Now, my teacher is very intriguing because the maybe is very strong. When I first saw the teacher, I said, maybe. Very strong maybe. Because there's a very strong maybe there. Very intriguing. Because you can say, wait a minute, it's just maybe. But I see, yes, I see. The maybe's there so that there's opportunity to work through and then get to the yes. I see. But the maybe is definitely there. But people look at the teacher and say, I don't know. Maybe, I don't know. maybe. And it's like, so it's a really great maybe there. Really great maybe. So that's why I'd say it's going to be very, very successful. You know, that maybe is going to be very successful. It's like Muji, you know, is a maybe, right? Muji is a very strong maybe. You look at the guy and say, you know, maybe. So you get these maybes, different maybes that come up. For me, Muji is still a maybe. My teacher, I can see it's a yes. Because it just, somehow the maybe is so right, you know, that I can see, the transparency is so good I can see it. But Muji, I was never quite able to get to the point where it's a definite yes, you know. So I had to move on to where you get the yes, like it's like, yes. And then the ultimate yes is where you accept your own role as maybe. And then that's how you really have to get to yes. You can't just stop with the teacher. You know, you can't just stop there. You've got to bring that maybe into the world also. My teacher's ridiculously effective, maybe. This is ridiculous. Super, super effective, maybe. Which Muji may be for others, you know. Muji may be ridiculously effective, maybe, for others. But only they know, see it that way, right? You know, whatever teacher you find, it's just right for you because you know, ridiculously effective maybe. You just say, wow, that's ridiculously effective. and someone else may not be quite as ridiculously effective, so you just say, well, it's great, but not quite ridiculously effective. And it's like, wow. eaten since yesterday's lunch. Almost 24 hours, actually. Oh, you'd eat just a little bit, snack a little bit. It's too important to eat right now. What's more important, this or eating? As this is more important than eating. Forget about eating. You know, just to keep up maybe appearances, I'll eat, you know, maybe some, but... Again, the silence is like this. It's incredibly situation. This is just like huge. And just sitting there quietly. It's so huge. I just don't want to do anything. Just let me just stay out of this. The amount of clarity is opening up, you know, opening up a door to this just like huge situation. Don't even know, you know, how to function in that or what to do. Iconoclasts just don't know how to tackle the continuity fear. Not aware of the Holy Spirit. I think that they have to do it, you know, using adjustments somehow. Or just throw all adjustments away. Just say, let's just, you know, forget it. But we can't just forget it. We have to honor our creativity. So, all praise and blessings to all iconoclasts everywhere. May they be, you know, helped to the utmost extent by the Holy Spirit. Good intentions, very good intentions. They have to go past those to wisdom. So may they get the utmost help and the right maybes. There's a little bit of shuddering and sort of slight physical shifts taking place. Have been during the taping. But you can see it's just very minor. Nothing I really pay attention to. People will say, what about the body part? So maybe. No teacher here really can truly be all things to everybody. Bootstrap the whole thing. Each teacher has their own unique maybe-ness. What happens is spiritual egotism tries to be like the greatest teacher. I can teach everybody in all levels, all phases. No, that doesn't happen. That doesn't happen that way. That's still being very iconoclastic, actually. Spiritually iconoclastic. You cannot have one uber teacher like that, actually, here in the world. Because each teacher has sort of a unique, every teacher has a story, is the thing. Meaning, to the world, they were born somewhere, they live somewhere, they have a story. Nobody can have the exact same story here. It's impossible. So everything seems unique here. And so the maybe that a teacher brings forth is going to seem unique. And some will be find it to be an absolutely amazing maybe. A ridiculous maybe, right? Just a completely ridiculous maybe. It's wow. And others will not. Because their own quote-unquote story, they think their uniqueness of being is none are the same. It's impossible, as Jesus said, it's impossible to get a universal quote-unquote curriculum. He's speaking in pragmatic terms, I believe, because everyone does have the same problem, which is the continuity problem. That is universal, that is absolutely true. But in pragmatic terms, you cannot have this, it's possible everyone have the same curriculum. It's impossible. Because you need to have a ridiculously effective maybe in order to get past this, the trouble, the continuity issue here. And because of everybody's uniqueness in the story that they think they are, it's impossible to get everybody on the same page. It's not possible. Because, you know, you like for me, like seeing Muji, I say, yeah, that's really, you know, maybe, but it's not ridiculously maybe. It's not just incredible, you know, for me. It's not quite there for me, but it may be there for other people. Maybe a lot of people said, wow, that's there for me. But you cannot ever have everybody on the same page saying this teacher is exactly what I need. You know, this is not, it doesn't work that way. And so we've had these iconoclastics who in history who insist, you know, no, this teacher is the only one, you know, this is the way, everyone has to do it this way. Again, that's this type of good intentions, very iconoclastic, thinking that we can just push past this continuity problem, push it aside through just this direct will sort of approach. That doesn't work, as we've seen the horrible religious wars. I mean, right now, you know, we've got the the Sunnis and the Shiites. And it's been going on since, what, 632 or something like that. battle between, you know, is it a succession for Muhammad? Is it the family, Ali, or is it by consensus? Is it, you know, does the community of fault believers pick, you know, choose their leader, or is it through direct, you know, lineage, descent from the family? And I think that the Shiites believe it's like through direct descent, and the Sunnis say it's through consensus, we choose our own leaders type of thing. And they've been fighting over that since, you know, 632. That's a long time, isn't it? 1500 years or close to that or something. It's 14, whatever. Many, 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 many centuries of conflict, you know. Wow. Because each one says, no, this is ridiculously effective. And the other groups, the Sunnis say, wait, we want to pick our own ridiculously effective ones. And the Shiites say, no, we inherently, this lineage is going to be ridiculously effective. And there's a maybe to both. You see, there's a maybe to both. They have to meet on the ground of maybe. The more we can get maybe into the world in a ridiculously effective way, the more these tensions will die down, actually. So in some ways, progress is being made here. In some ways, progress is being made, actually. It doesn't seem like progress, though, does it? It seems like a collapse into anarchy in some ways, in some people's minds. But it's not. India's been ahead of a lot of that because so many, they have this seeming spiritual anarchy, but there's so many teachers there that are ridiculously effective, maybe for some, you see. And so you have this massive, disorganized plurality kind of thing. You just, you know, that's what really works very well. That's why you get these great teachers there. That's why the great teachers come there. In these ages, you know, there's been a lot. And you're not getting it like in Catholicism. I mean, Catholicism is desperate. They're elevating people to sainthood that just, you know, man, they're just squeezing, trying to get blood out of a turnip. Because they're insisting that there's this one ridiculously effective maybe for everyone, and this is the only one. You got to do it this way. And it, obviously, I go to Mass, have been for quite some time. I don't know how long, 5 years, every week. It's not ridiculously effective for a lot of people there. For some, it may be. For some, it may be. But for a lot, no way. No way. And the momentum of the institution is such, you know, they say, well, we can't have anarchy. Well, you can have a pluralism, you know, pluralism. You know, but they don't trust that. They don't trust it. And into this vacuum in the world is arising a lot of very bad stuff. Like in the Sunni-Shiite conflict, there's some really, you know, intense stuff arising right now. And this lack of a very ridiculously maybe, let's meet on the ground of maybe here. Let's everyone meet on that ground instead of a super rigid iconoclastic ground like, this is the only way, this is the one that is the only way, and take it or leave it. But save time. They think they're saving time that way. They're not. They're actually delaying. They're delaying. Into that vacuum has arisen a lot of opportunists that are, you know, causing tremendous difficulties for sure. But perhaps that can be overcome if we get to this enough ridiculous maybes in the world, a 100 monkey type of thing. People may catch on and people say, hey, maybe pluralism really will work here. We don't need the big mother goddess cult. We don't need the patriarchal cult. We can have this plurality, true plurality cult of ridiculously ridiculous maybe. Like, this is just such a ridiculous maybe, I just can't resist this maybe. It's so incredible. That is what will work, actually. So there is some hope for that. I gotta do my part in that. That's how I see it. ridiculous maybe is people say, wow, this one looks like they could be super helpful. But so let's just make sure they don't go too far. maybe we can make a deal here. It's like, it's part of this whole complex of being attracted to that and let it happen. And then people get off this whole self-destructive trip that they're on. And, you know, like the Sunni who's calling for a caliphate and insisting all jihadists should join that. You know, there's all these other rebel groups who are saying, now forget it. No, you're not our leader. Forget it. So the Sunnis cannot accomplish what they're trying because their whole thing is we choose our own leaders. So all these different factions, there's just factions everywhere, and they're choosing their own leaders, so they cannot unite. They cannot unite. The caliphate, you know, to unite and stuff, it's not going to happen because the very essence of what they're about is that we choose our own leaders, each community, you know, that kind of thing, which is what Protestantism was really about, right? Protestantism was all about that. Actually, a step in the right direction. Now, the Shiite can unite better because they're not choosing the consent. The leadership is not so much a consensus-driven thing, and they can, you know, one powerful dictator say, "Hey, you know, I'm it," and they can, you know, coalesce around that more easily. Which is why you have a minority of Shiites in various places like Iraq and Syria in control and ruling, in a lot of ways, because they can be extremely loyal to one leader, whereas the Sunnis will fragment and fraction into all sorts of plurality sort of situations. So you got this deadlock kind of thing, like Protestantism and Catholicism. You had the wars, the European wars, 100-year wars, and all this stuff. You're getting that in the Islam now. It's been going on for a long time, but you're really getting intense as the wars in Christianity went on for a long time. And now it's easing into more of a plurality. Even Catholicism is starting to ease into more of a plurality. But again, the opportunists jumping in and say, no, let's establish this new institution, which I call radical feminism, goddess worship. They're jumping into that and saying they think they see an opportunity to present, you know, unified, this is it picture. Whereas plurality is saying no to that. No. We're going to choose our own ridiculous maybes. Because we're willing to take up the work that entails a lot of work, whereas a rigid, you know, new feminist, new world order, feminist goddess worshiping institution thing will say, look, you don't need to do any work, just accept us as your authority, and you don't have to do any work, we'll just tell you what to do. Whereas if you find a true teacher who's just ridiculous maybe, and you just have to see this and see it through, that's a lot of work. It's a lot of work. A lot of tough work. But there are many who are up for that, you know. They're not going to take the lazy way out. So it remains to be seen what's going to happen in this world, isn't it? Because you do have these desperate attempts to establish new institutions, a new caliphate, a new, you know, new world order, new world feminist goddess, new world order. There's desperate attempts to establish that, desperate attempts to establish a caliphate. And so, desperate attempts to reestablish the Catholic Church. Pope Francis is trying to hold on to the power of the Church by desperately doing what he's doing. So you see, guys, got a lot of desperation in the world right now, a ton of desperation, because they want us the lazy way. They want to say, let's get back to the lazy way here. We don't want this to really engage on the spiritual path. There must be an iconoclastic lazy way where we just decree that the continuity problem doesn't exist, therefore it doesn't exist. That's not going to work. It'll never work. You cannot decree it out of existence. That's the one problem you cannot decree away. Cannot. It's there. So, as the Holy Spirit told me, look, you're either going to be lazy or not. You either choose a lazy life or not. It's up to you. And I said, wow, no way. I'm not going to be lazy. Forget it. And that's it with everyone. It's either you're going to go the lazy way or not. So I don't know. It's hard to handicap the world for sure. those who want to establish these, you know, new institutions, they try to say they're the only way. This is the way. Of course, they may claim it's plurality, where it's just establishing an institutional. But no, that's not true. That's not true. You don't establish an institutional plurality. Plurality is something organic that happens in a deep way, spiritual way in your life. Nobody's telling you. You're guided from within. You cannot establish an institutional plurality, which is what feminism is claiming. They're going to establish this wonderful golden age institutional plurality. It doesn't happen that way. You cannot do it that way. That kills the goose that laid the golden egg. Absolutely. So, but that's, you know, that's all, that's very trendy now. It's very trendy in the world too. Let's establish institutions of plurality, so to speak. You know, quotas everywhere, right? Diversity everywhere, by law, you know, let's establish. That is not ridiculously effective, maybe. That actually works at all. It doesn't work at all. And we should have learned that by now in history. And I think a lot of us have realized that doesn't work in the hard way. So let's get to this ridiculous maybe. Let's find our ridiculous maybes. I certainly have found one. It's just like, wow. Now, I'm not saying that could be the only one necessarily. No, I'm not saying that necessarily, but maybe it is the final one, you know. Maybe I have to be the next, be one also. Definitely, it's either that or the, you know, highway, you know. It's either the that or death, you know, at this point. So let's do it. I told the Holy Spirit, yes, let's do it. It's fine. So this is all part of the rollout, you know. It's rolling out somehow. Working at it here. There's no time to stop, you know. Just, you it's funny seeing the way the world is funny. It's very predictable, actually. We think it's not predictable. It's actually very predictable. You don't expect. The ridiculous maybe is you see someone that's a match for the world. The world has met its match, and yet it seems ridiculously improbable. So you say, like, wow, very intense maybe, you know. It's just, yeah, maybe, but really? I gotta investigate this. I gotta look into this. This is really, wow, is that possible? Wow, I'm just so intrigued. So your intrigue gets pulled into it. That's what's necessary. There's a plurality of intrigue. So intrigue needs to be directed into all these different pluralistic situations that are super effective. You cannot have one situation that's ridiculously effective that pulls the intrigue in for everybody. So you cannot, establishing institutions isn't going to work anymore. especially Big Mother claiming this is the problem, that they know how to deal with plurality, so they need to be in charge of the institution of plurality. That's not going to work either. That is the catch. That is the fly in the ointment. That is the problem with the world right now, big time. It's like, well, Mother is used to having all these different children, and she's fair to each one. She's very pluralistic. No, but Mother always insists that she knows best. And it does. She is the institution, and the children don't like that. And the Mother gets very bitter about that, cuts them off, takes severe sanctions against them. Doesn't work. Big Mother doesn't work. And that's what, you know, the world thinks, oh, we need to have some, you know, doesn't trust yet. That it's trying to say, no, we must do this. Well, that's another cycle of ineffectiveness, actually. Coming up short, you come up short, and that's no good. Remember, the realization is there is no start, there is no beginning. It doesn't matter what type of beginning you come up with, as long as you're coming up with a beginning and an ending, no matter how grandiose or great or beautiful or wonderful, you're still deluded. There's still total delusion there. It's not effective. Doesn't work. And Big Mother says, don't worry, I'll be your beginning. See? Everyone knows the Mother is the beginning of your life, so I'll be this really benign beginning. Everyone, see, they make it easy for you. You just accept this is your beginning. Everyone agrees they have the same beginning, and then we're all on the same page, you see. Then we have oneness. We all accept that we have the same beginning. It's oneness. That's the problem with this coming, you know, matriarchal, goddess-worshipping cult of the world, New World Order, is everyone's going to insist they have the same beginning. Same life, same beginning. They think they're on the same page with oneness. We got the oneness back. No, that's what doesn't work. Now, you can have female teachers, more the merrier, please. However is ridiculously and catches our intrigue as ridiculous, maybe, male or female of any age, great. Absolutely. It's a completely different issue. The issue is institutionalization is the issue of plurality. That's the catch. That's what doesn't work. That's what Ananda Mayama rejected. She rejected it. She was offered, you know, you can be the head of the New World Order. She literally was placed in her hands and they insisted, you're the only one that can do it. Literally, she was given the keys to the world. And she said, thanks, but no thanks. Not even a thought. Just, you know, not able to do it. Sorry. Like that. She says, How can you have this crazy little girl be in charge of all this massive new institution you want to present to the world? I'm just a crazy little girl. You can't have me do that. So right there, that right there shows you. You know, that's real authority there. The one that knows there is no beginning and no ending. The one that is totally is. The allness of universal being says, no, I'm not going to be head of any institution here. That's, you can't get any more profound than that. You know, that's it. What did she do? Went around supporting plurality. Men teachers, women teachers. She supported women being teachers, yes. Supported plurality. But she went around supporting plurality all over the place. Pumping up every teacher, every situation, unique situations. Not trying to establish any sort of institution, an umbrella that's underneath all of them. Yeah, let the umbrella fly away. Let it go. Don't try to get it back. Sri Anandamaya Maharaj has been instrumental in my in helping me through these ways of spiritual diplomacy, rejecting institutionalization, support of plurality, including the support of women. She absolutely supported women being taking the spiritual path and being spiritual teachers, absolutely, which I absolutely support. What I reject categorically is the institutionalization of plurality under the umbrella of feminism, of matriarchy. Absolutely, that would be a disaster. Absolute disaster. It already is a disaster, because it's already here, and it's a disaster for the world. Just as the Sunnis want to establish a caliphate of plurality, that's also a disaster, isn't it? They want to enforce on this one umbrella of we demand that everyone have this particular, you know, pluralism like this. You can't do it that way, because pluralism is organic. So don't fight to rid the world of institutions, you know, because those can be ridiculously effective, maybe for some too, you see? So don't be iconoclastic, say, no, pluralism must completely rule on this planet, I'm going to make sure that everything is pluralistic, I'm going to put all these controls in, force. You lose the path. Throw out the baby with the bathwater. This is the intellect. Feminists are very intellectual, very academic, very intellectual, very idealistic of it. Don't have the spiritual wisdom. They want to think they can enforce this. They're very iconoclastic, actually. They'll set quotas, they end up setting quotas to everything. They'll put all their henchwomen in bureaucracies of enforcing quotas on everyone. And then they'll become their own, you know, their own institution of all this hierarchy and everything. Same old thing. They'll say, okay, how many women are in your class? How many men? How many women are following you? How many men are following you? We've got to make sure the right balance here. And how many women are teaching, how many men are teaching, I make sure they're right, I'm glad exactly, you know, gotta have, like, perfect plurality. And this completely misses the baby, overlooks the baby entirely, which is a situation which is ridiculously intriguing, because you just can't believe how could it possibly be like this, you know, it's just like, wow, the world's met its match this way? So you don't attain that through quotas. Don't attain it through quotas. That is intellectual idealism. And it's the worst thing ever. It's the worst thing ever. It's the same old, same old. Same old, same old. Church, Catholic Church, tried to impose that on everyone. It broke down into plurality, and there were times when it was more pluralistic, and times when it tried to be non-plural, you know, tried to enforce its idea of pluralism. Thinking it was, you know, and it's history, it's just history. You see the history, the tides of history, just the tides. And now we're in this big tidal situation now. Of attempting to enforce, you know, intellectual pluralism, which again overlooks the child entirely, the real child of spiritual, the true child, completely overlooks it. It's not important. It overlooks what is truly important, to focus on all the trees, overlooks the forest, it doesn't see what is really important at all. And therefore, it completely pushes out what's important, tries to for sure. See, it doesn't matter. Quotas doesn't matter. You can have some teacher may attract, you know, all one type of person or something, or all a very similar thing. Another teacher may be more diverse there. So, you know, you can't enforce this idea of diversity. It's ridiculous. Because everyone's unique. And the uniqueness of everyone has to play out. You cannot force everyone on the same page. They will just stagnate. You'll get this new world order goddess cult will just stagnate, and then they'll try to prevent stagnation. They'll produce more and more entertainment, which is what television does, right? I mean, everybody's stagnated, and the desperate, and the institutions are still trying to, you know, hey, look at this, look at these dancing women, you know, and bears, and look at these monsters, and look at this war, and, you know, more and more entertainment, more and more entertainment, because people are stagnant. They're loyal to the institution, you know, and so this new world order, global feminism, goddess cult will become incredibly stagnant. And then they'll try to say, hey, you know, you're not stagnant. You just need to keep doing what we're telling you to do. It's going to work. The Catholic Church is very stagnant. Again, I'm speaking from direct experience here. I'm not just some intellectual saying this. I have religiously attended Mass. I know all the entire seasons of the Church, the pomp and the circumstance, the people, everything. I've seen everything. And it's stagnant. It is stagnant, which leaves people wide open for this entertainment, sex, drugs, rock and roll, entertainment thing. Paganism, heathenism, paganism. It's coming back like crazy. You know, let's go drop ecstasy and go to a rave. You know, let's just, you know, let's just, we're stagnant. Institutionalism always brings about this kind of stagnation. And then what happens in this vacuum jumps another institution. Says, hey, posing as pluralism, another institution. So feminism posed as pluralism is another institution. It's an extreme institution, actually. Same with this Obama character. He posed as Mr. Pluralism. He's an extreme institutionalist. An extreme institutionalist, actually. As are the feminists who are advising him, actually. There's actually this New World Order, which is an extreme institutionalism posing as pluralism. Oh, sure, I'm all for pluralism, the middle class, and all that. Nonsense. And of course, the people see through it. A lot of people see through it, and they're furious about this, you know. They're furious. They want to institutionalize, like, contraception is another issue, big issue, right? Abortion, all this stuff, they say, this is the way it has to be done. People say, whoa, 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 no, no, no. A lot of women says, no, we don't want big government supplying my contraception or whatever. I don't want that. I want my own freedom here. I don't want to be, see, they don't want it. And of course, women are shocked, like, how could you possibly not go with our new pluralistic institution, which is going to be run by women? You have great power in this institution, you know. What are you talking about? They say, no, 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 no. That doesn't ring my bell. It doesn't ring my bell. So there's always going to be a ton of people who don't fit into the new institution, that, you know, a ton of them. What are they going to do with those? Well, what did the Sunnis do with the Shiites that they captured? You saw it right there. You know, swift justice, right? It's exactly what happens. The new pluralistic institution was going to execute anybody that, you know, stands in their way. As a fact. Yeah, I've seen that. I know I'm speaking from fact here, from direct experience. The Obama situation, the radical feminists expected way more. The New World Order institutionalists expected him to pull the trigger, and he didn't. He didn't pull the trigger because he wanted his legacy. He wanted a legacy, and he knew if he pulled the trigger, his would be a very tarnished legacy. Because so many people, you know, would just be so furious with him. So he tried to, he said, okay, let's work, let's re-educate these people. Well, the feminists are super mad at him, super mad. The new goddess cult bureaucracy is super mad at him because he didn't pull the trigger the way they wanted him to. They're boiling mad with him. Because he is a politician. he's not an actual super radical. He's being used by the super radicals. He is, Obama's actually a politician. He's a narcissist politician. He cares about his legacy a great deal. A great deal, as does Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton also cares about his legacy. So they do, Clinton, you know, really cares, but Obama a little, he's taking a much harder line, but he does, the bottom line is he cares about his, how he's viewed historically, his legacy. He doesn't really want to be seen as this, you know, total, vicious, radical. Does not. So they're using him. And he's willing to be used because he wants to be seen as historic. But he's not doing what they want. And so, he's getting it from both sides. Which is why he wants out of there. He says, I feel like a bear in a cage. I want out. I want, let me out. I just want to go talk to people. Come on. I just want to say, look, I really am for you. You know what I mean? Well, he really wants to say, I just want to go work on my legacy here. Come on. I want to build a legacy for myself. And these factions, man, just not letting me do it. I just want to go out and shake somebody's hand and say, hey, I'm a historic person. Nice to meet you. You know? The world would just say, okay, maybe, you know, fine, maybe you're a historic person, you know. Then things would relax, actually. Things would relax. He's not the terrible person that people think. He's being used. He's a front person for a really terrible agenda, actually. He couldn't resist. But he does have the capacity. If you said, you know what, maybe you are going to be a historic person, Barack. Maybe. Nice to meet you. Let's play some golf. Maybe you will be a historic. Maybe you'll be a historic. And let's just leave it at maybe. You know what? He's going to say, hey, that's kind of cool. I kind of like that. I kind of like that. And we need to say the same thing to Hillary. Hey, maybe you will be a great historic person. Maybe, you know, maybe, absolutely, maybe. Soften it up. Otherwise, you know, these radicals keep getting these front people. Of course, these radicals cannot operate openly. They have to have a very convincing front person for them. But their goal is definitely, a radical feminist goal is definitely to install a new world order, radical institution that controls everything here. Absolutely. They're super iconoclastic. No maybes with them. No maybes with them. They think they can get rid of the continuity problem by saying, everybody, we're going to tell you who your teacher is. We're going to tell you who your teacher is because we know best. That's what they're all about. So if you really want to, even to the radical feminist goddess worshiper, say, okay, well, maybe your institution, you know, maybe you can do that and be helpful as possible. Maybe there's a nice maybe there for sure. Now they won't take that as easily as others for sure. They're hardliners for sure, but you can do it to everybody. And it'll soften the whole situation up. But actually, spiritual teachers soften the whole situation up for the whole world. That is a fact. Sri Ananda Maima softened up the world intensely off of this iconoclastic. And you may think, well, it's males that need to be softened. No, not just males. Women are, if anything, way more rigid towards institutions. They just want to be the ones ruling the institution. They can be extremely rigid. So they have to be softened up too, big time. The mythology that women are some really soft, you know, intrinsically soft is not true at all. Not true. Who came up with that canard? It's absolutely ridiculous. Who's ever met a woman that's actually truly really soft? Yeah, they're very rigid. They have a good act, a velvet glove, you know, but they can be extremely dogmatic and rigid and demanding. Which is why they're political animals. I say women should never got into politics or academia, where two places of institutionalized rigidity, which you don't want rigid people there. And females are more rigid, in my opinion, but they're able to put on a very cutesy makeup, nice soft act, but they're tough. Like Hillary Clinton is absolutely tough as nails. Are you kidding? Bill Clinton's way softer. Hillary Clinton is ferocious. Super rich. And so, which is a problem because it's people are seeing it. Wow, she's a very, very rigid, iconoclastic, idealistic, my way or the highway, there is no maybe to it person, you know? So women can pretend to go along a lot, but inside, they can be very brittle, very uncompromising, very no maybe to them, extremely so. Men can actually be quite much softer. They seem to be able to get to maybe a little easier. Now this is a general statement. Some women can get to maybe too, absolutely. But this overall stereotype is women as being soft. You know, the feminists say, hey, you can't stereotype anybody. The liberal progressives, you know, they say, that's all evil, evil, evil. Well, they're the ones who do the most stereotyping of all. They say, women are inherently soft and compromising and maybe in consensus reaching. That's all total stereotyping. They're just stereotyping themselves in a positive light. While claiming stereotyping is so evil, you know, because they're afraid that people will see through them and say, hey, all you radicals are very idealistically uncompromising, no maybe to it, like super iconoclastic, thinking you can force a solution to the continuity problem, which you cannot. And they say, you can't stereotype us that way. You can't say that this way won't work. That's like saying what's impossible, those who are trying to do it, say, you can't stereotype it, that impossible, we can't do the impossible. Yes, we can. That's not a stereotype, it's a fact. So yeah, okay, we won't stereotype, but we're talking with facts. It doesn't work. That's a fact. It'll never work, that's a fact. So getting to maybe, the real maybe, is a ridiculous maybe. You just see something like, wow, the world has met its match this way? Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? Wow, I'm really intrigued by that. That's getting to that, then, wow, the whole world attitude changes. Which is why Ananda Maimaya helped the world out so much. Because people just like just blew their mind. They couldn't just say, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? The world has met its match in this? And indeed it has. It just said, wow, I'm intrigued by this. This is truly intriguing. A lot of men of power are very intrigued by her because it's like, wow. The world met its match in this way. It can meet its match in this way. And they said, my gosh, they soften up to maybe. Okay. But it's not because she's just a woman, it's just the total overall circumstances. See, nowadays it's turned around. You know, nowadays maybe if a man, the world meets its match in a man, the world will just say, wow, that's incredible. How's that possible? We thought for sure, we stereotyped for sure that can never happen here. This is very intriguing. Very intriguing. Maybe the feminists, radical feminists, will be very intrigued. And that will soften the whole thing up. They'll say, forget this institutional thing. This is even more intriguing. It's even more intriguing. We thought this is impossible. We thought this is impossible, but yet it's happened. I think maybe it's happened. Like, wow. Wait a minute. I'm intrigued by this. See, taking the edge of intrigue off of institutionalization is what is super helpful. Super helpful. Supporting genuine pluralism, which is not a political or social movement. It's a movement you actually do with your life, with your own intrigue and intrepidness and efforts. That's how it happens. That's how it happens. A lot of tough work is how it happens, actually. See, Protestantism, high Protestantism, came about because of a lot of people putting a lot of tremendous study and work into their Bibles, into their prayer. And, you know, they just work, you know, workaholics. They really worked at it. And out of that came new thought, came, you know, various high expressions that were more than before, okay, really more than before, because people actually had to work at it instead of just being dictated to by an institution. which works for a few, for some. For some, that can work too, because that's ridiculously intriguing too, right? Maybe too. It can be. It can be, absolutely. So there was the New Thought was an expression of the Protestant. What happened with that? And so there were a lot of, like, wow, people are, you know, talking this very tremendously high way of expression, etc. So there's an example of pluralism working, and then there's always this tidal force back and forth between real pluralism, which is hard work, and institutionalism. People become lazy. When people get lazy, they want institutionalism. That's the world now. Very lazy place. I'm talking with a friend of mine who's like the antithesis of lazy. It's like the most non-lazy person I've ever met. Unbelievable. I just amazed. Holy cow. It's not a lazy bone in his body. You know, just... And he says, hey, the world's becoming so lazy. The world is so unbelievably lazy. You know, he can see it, obviously. The world's very lazy. No respect for others' hard work, you know. So many lazy people just want a government to take care of them, just want someone to take care of them. That's it, we're so lazy. Because institutionalization eventually leads to laziness. So the world is very lazy. So they're ripe for some other institution to spring up and grab a hold of all these lazy people and says, don't worry, we'll take care of you, we'll tell you what to do. That's what's happening. And of course, a lot of people who still have some of that true work ethic say, hey, we don't want laziness to rule the roost here. Come on, we want our own choice. We have the right to choose because through our hard work. You know, same with spiritual path. You know, I have the right to choose because of my hard work. I can choose my own teacher. You know, the teacher that I'm right now, I said, okay, this teacher is my teacher right now. I'm not putting any limits, how long or whatever. No, just right now, this is my teacher. See, that's a result of hard work on my part. Tremendous hard work. I'm not going to have anybody tell me who my teacher is going to be because I earned the right to choose my own teacher. See, it's ultimately the Holy Spirit guided me to it. I earned the right for the Holy Spirit to guide me to who my teacher is. What is the situation for me that's just like, wow, I'm intrigued. It's ridiculously ridiculous. Maybe here, like, are you kidding me? I earned the right. I earned the right through incredible hard work. So, absolutely, I am adamant that hard work pays off. It should pay off. We should not have this leveling, institutional leveling of the globe. Because from that point, where are you going to go? Back to pluralism, actual hard work, people succeeding again. Always. You look at socialism, how it always works. There's always people where we're going to work harder than others. There are always people who say, I want it more. I really want this more. I'm going to do everything I can to get this. And others will say, well, I don't want that much. Always. Who thinks they can bring this equality to the planet? It's absolutely nuts. It's academic insanity. Lack of wisdom. Severe continuity problem, lack of wisdom, etc. So again, I earn the right to choose my own teacher. Because through all the tough work I've done, I'm able to say, hey, recognize it. This is helpful now. I can see it. I can feel it. I know it. Recognize. Now the institutions say, no, you can't do that. It's too effective. We'll lose our effect. If that happens, we'll lose our power and effectiveness. So the institutions don't want to lose their own power. Once you get institutions, they don't want to lose that power. So if we re-empower another massive global institution, we're really going to be sunk here. Because they're not going to want to let go of their power at all. And if it's global, then, you know, it's curtains here. I think it's going to be really tough. And that's what's happening. That's what's happening. It's a global institution that they're going for. Now, the Catholic Church is supposed to be a global institution. But this one coming is even more so because it incorporates even it's going to be even much greater institution. The church will just be part of that institution, actually. Actually, the New World Order is going to use the Catholic Church and all other institutions as its, you know, as its hands and feet, and it'll work for the New World Order, but the New World Order is a much, much massiver institution, actually. And they're not going to want to give up their power to true plurality at all. You're not going to say, hey, I want to choose my bureaucrat, I want to choose my leader, I want to choose my spiritual teacher. They're going to say, we have algorithms that take care of that for you, don't worry. We got that covered too. We'll never work that way. That's a fail from the beginning. It's a fail from the beginning. It's the result of our educational system, really. Very bad educational system. Through very bad premises. I think you blame John Locke or, you know, Aristotle and et cetera. But even, you know, just blame academia. Academia is not where it's at. Academia is like for those who don't want to be lazy but still are lazy. It's an intermediate step, kind of. Spiritual path is for those who don't want to be lazy and aren't lazy. Big difference. Academia is just posturing, the saying, you know, I really don't want to be lazy, but I am. That's what it is. I don't really want to be lazy. I really hate being lazy, but I still am lazy. That's academia, bureaucracy, politicians, all those people that, you know, try to get power over others. They don't want to be seen as lazy, but they are. Whereas on the spiritual path, you don't want to be seen as lazy, and you're not. And so, of course, the bureaucrats, they don't like the difference, because they'll be seen as they are lazy. They don't want that to be seen. So they work so hard, it's controlled and suppression and everything. You know, just work so hard, but they're still being lazy. If they just put that effort into actual not being lazy, it would be a spiritual path for them. Just a little more effort, and it's a spiritual path. The spiritual path requires a little extra effort. A little extra effort. Just a little bit. So instead of going to that cocktail party and schmoozing, you're actually saying, well, no, wait, I got this tremendous breakthrough. I've got to stay with that. That's it. So that's the only difference, you know. Here. You know, I reached the 2-hour mark a long time ago, and I guess I should quit and stop. I said, no. I'm on a roll here. Let's give a little extra effort here. A little extra effort. We don't have to succumb to the New World Order, but I'm saying for sure the only way to avoid it is to soften it up through a positive maybe, through your own intrigue, shifting to a ridiculous maybe, where you think you've found someone who's a match for the world, who's the world has met its match in this one. The world has met its match. Now, for many, that would like be Jesus Christ. Okay, that's fine. If that works, if that truly works, if that truly pulls you out of your laziness, you're no longer, you know, you're truly intrigued, you're truly okay, absolutely, whatever situation it is. But simply, do not become institutional about it and insist that everybody else has had the exact same situation, because the uniqueness, it won't happen that way. And even in Christianity, as a matter of fact, what I found is everybody has a different viewpoint on Jesus. Everyone almost is incredible. No two people have the same viewpoint on Jesus. So each one thinks that they've got Jesus. The next person thinks they got Jesus. And it's all different. And they kind of get together and say, yeah, we all got the same Jesus. No, they don't. Absolutely not. Very different. Very, very different. Just interpretations of Scripture. Very, very, very different. So you have to be honest with yourself and say, what is actually working for me? What is actually working? Is this helping me be still and quiet and overcome the shock of realizing that I don't have any beginning? I don't have any beginning. There is no beginning. Being does not have a beginning. It's all one. There's only one universal being. That's it. There's only one universal being. All is universal being right now. There's only all is universal being right now. That's it. Is that getting me to it? Is there that intrigue, really? Or am I trying to institutionalize things? If you're trying to institutionalize stuff, it's not it. It's not it. It doesn't matter who you think you're following. If your purpose is more to institutionalize it, it's not it for you. Same with the Course in Miracles. There's a lot of people who try to institutionalize it. Then for them, it's not it. It's not it. They're going around, you know, they're big wigs and saying, yeah, blah, 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 but they're trying to institutionalize it. For them, it's not it then. It's not it. I mean, some of the most notable people in the Course in Miracles are simply trying to institutionalize it. It's not for them. The Course is not for them then. It's not for them, even though they're the ones who are supposed to be who seem to be the leaders of A Course in Miracles. A lot of them, actually, A Course in Miracles is not for them. See? Because it's more about institutionalizing it for them. So it's not for them. For me, it was for me. Because I never had any thought of institutionalizing it, actually. Not at all. I even set it down. That means it really was for me. If you see a teacher and your purpose is to institutionalize them, that teacher's not for you, actually. Whereas if you are truly intrigued, beyond even institutionalizing, and it's just like, wow, you know, what is this? It's just, and you just stop dead in your tracks like this. The search for a beginning to what you are, stop dead in its tracks. Then you got something, because that's your intrigue with that, okay? And no, you're not trying to institutionalize that. Oh, no, no, no. It's like, whoa. What am I trying to institutionalize? There's no beginning. There's no ending. How can that be institutionalized? So a lot of the church institutions, a lot of people in charge of them, it's like Catholicism. It's actually that has not been for them. They tried to institutionalize it, you know, too much emphasis on institutionalization. Now, of course, you want to spread the news, but too much emphasis on institutionalization is not for them. It is not for them. And they're more drunk on the idea of a legacy and history and institutionalization. In other words, I had a start. I had a part in beginning and ending. I had a part in time. And they're more interested in that than realizing there is no time. There is no beginning or ending. So, gets off track, right? Something's wrong here. Something's wrong. So you get that always here, even with the Course in Miracles. It's no different. It's no different. I know a lot of people thought, I hope it doesn't happen. Well, it certainly has happened. Not to a significant extent in a lot of ways, but it definitely has happened. There's been attempts, great attempts, right? You know what I'm talking about. I'm not going to use this video to talk about names here. But no question, there's been some heavyweight efforts to institutionalize that, to fold it into the New World Order institutionalization. Same with theosophy. See, here's the thing. I don't think everybody in theosophy was trying to institutionalize it. There's a lot of good teachings there, but it has been folded into the New World Order, no question about it. been folded into the United Nations, it's been folded into the New World Order. That is absolutely true. And that's not the one moment, is it? So on and on and on it goes. You have to be aware of this whole dynamic, that not everybody in a situation that's helpful for them wants to institutionalize it, but some will institutionalize it and push for that, and then it'll seem to be, you know, wow, what happened? This isn't right, you know, kind of thing. You've got to be very wise about that. But again, do not allow yourself to be stuck in any way. Insist on this maybe. Insist on the maybe for it. Okay, maybe institutionalization is fine, or maybe it's not. This is a maybe. Maybe I'm go with it. Maybe I won't. You know, don't get polarized. Don't let yourself get polarized over anything. Be diplomatic here. Don't be polarized. Then you'll feel free to choose what is truly helpful for you. A lot of people are very upset because they don't have what's truly helpful for them, and they keep trying to hammer away. No, say maybe. Be more diplomatic. And then you'll say, well, maybe I have a right to this incredible maybe here. And you will. You'll find some incredible books, some incredible teaching. I found so much incredible in my life. It's just on and on. I'm like, wow. I choose this. I'm free to choose this. I'm free to put my attention here. No, you know, I'm not going to have the world tell me where to put my attention. So just be in the maybe mode, maybe land. Dwell in maybe land. Because the more polarized the world gets, the more institutionalized it gets.